नमस्कार माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ मशीन डिजाइन। इन आवर प्रीवियस वीडियो यू वेर लर्न अबाउट द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ द बेरिंग, ओके, एंड द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ सेल्फ अलाइनिंग बेरिंग, देन सिलेक्शन ऑफ बेरिंग टाइप्स एंड स्टैटिक लोड कैरिंग कैपेसिटी ऑफ द बेरिंग, इन विच वी हैव डिराइव्ड द स्ट्राइबेक इक्वेशन टू फाइंड आउट द स्टैटिक लोड कैरिंग कैपेसिटी of a rolling contact bearing. Okay, now in this lecture, the rolling contact bearing part 3, okay, the different contents of this lectures: dynamic load carrying capacity, load life relationship of bearing, selection of bearing life, selections of bearing from the manufacturer's catalog, design for cyclic load and speeds, and cause of bearing failures and its remedies. Okay, now let us start with the dynamic load carrying capacity. So the life of a ball bearing is limited by the fatigue failure at the surface of ball and aces. So the dynamic load carrying capacity of the bearing is therefore based on the fatigue life of the bearing. So the life of an individual ball bearing is defined as the number of revolutions, or we can say hours of service at some given constant speed, which the bearing runs before the first evidence of fatigue crack in ball or races. Okay, so in short, we can say a numbers of revolution completed by the bearing, or a number of hours completed by the bearing before the first crack initiated in the bearing, that is called the life of the individual ball bearing. Okay, so since the life of the single bearing is difficult to predict, so it is necessary to define the life in terms of the statistical average performance of a group of bearings. So bearings are rated on one of the two criteria. The first one is the average life of a group of bearing, or the life which the 90% of the bearings will reach or exceed. Okay, so the second criteria is widely used in the bearing industry, that is the life which 90% of bearing will reach or exceed. Okay, now rating life. So what is the meaning of the rating life? So rating life of a group of apparently identical ball bearing is defined as the number of revolutions that the 90% of bearings will complete or exceed before the first evidence of the fatigue crack. Suppose a group of 100 bearings are there, okay, one group of 100 bearings. So as per the definition of the rating life, if the 90% of the bearing, that means the 90 bearings, okay, they have complete, okay, 90% of the numbers of revolution that the 90 bearings have complete before the first evidence of the crack. So that is called the rating life of that group of bearings. Okay, so there are number of terms used for this rating life. So they are minimum life, catalog life, okay, or L10 life or B10 life. Okay, so these terms are synonyms for rating lives. Okay, so we can use the different words, okay, catalog life, minimum life, L10, B10, but they are the rating life of that bearings. So in life, the life of an individual ball bearing may be different from the rating life. Okay, so statistically it can be proved that the life which the 50% of group of bearing will complete or exceed is approximately 5 times the rating life or L10 life. Okay, so this means that for the majority of bearing, the actual life is considerably more than the rated life. Okay, so the dynamic load carrying capacity. What is the meaning of the dynamic load carrying capacity? So the dynamic load carrying capacity of a bearing is defined as the radial load in radial bearings or thrust load in thrust bearing that can be carried for a minimum life of 1 million revolutions. It means a load, okay, for the radial load for the radial bearing and thrust load for the axial bearing. A load which can carry for minimum of 1 million revolution. A bearing which can carry a minimum load for the 1 million revolution. That is called its a dynamic load carrying capacity. So minimum life in this definition is the L10 life, which the 90% of the bearings will reach or exceed before the fatigue failure. Okay. So the dynamic load carrying capacity is based on the assumptions that the inner race is rotating while the outer race is stationary. So the formula for calculating the dynamic load capacity for different types of the bearings are standards. Okay, and we will see later on. So the manufacturer's catalog, it gives the ready-made values of dynamic load capacity of the bearing. Okay, now let us see the equivalent bearing load. So in actual applications, the force acting on the bearings has two components. Okay, one is the radial and other one is the thrust component. So it is therefore necessary to convert the two component acting on the bearing into a single hypothetical load, which fulfilling the conditions applied to the dynamic load carrying capacity. Okay. So then this hypothetical load, it can be compared with the dynamic load capacity. So the equivalent dynamic load is defined as the constant radial load in radial bearing or thrust load in thrust bearing, which if applied to the bearing would give same life as that which the bearing will attain under actual condition of forces. Okay, so once again, this equivalent bearing load is defined as the constant radial load in radial bearing and which is applied to the bearing would give same life as that which the bearing will attain under the actual condition of forces. So the equivalent radial load is given by one equation, P is equal to XV into FR plus Y into FA. Okay, XV FR plus Y into FA. Where this P is the equivalent load, FR is applied radial load with the value is constant, and FA is applied thrust load. Okay, this value is constant. Now, this factors, that is X and Y and V, these three are the factors. X is known as the radial factor, Y is known as a thrust factor, V is a rotational factor. Okay, so value of V is taken as 1 when the inner race rotates while outer race is held stationary, and value of V is taken as 1.2 when outer race rotates while inner race is held stationary. Okay, so these are the three factors, X, Y and V: radial factor, thrust factor and rotational factor. So you have to select the value of V according to the which race is stationary and which race is rotating. Okay. Then next one is the load life relationship. Okay, so the relationship between the dynamic load carrying capacity, the equivalent dynamic load, and the bearing life, okay, is given by one equation, and that equation is L10 is equal to C by P, okay, raised to small p. Okay, C by P raised to small p, where this L10 is the rated bearing life in million revolution. Okay, where capital C is the dynamic load capacity in Newton, small p, okay, value of small p is 3 for ball bearing, 10 by 3 for roller bearing. So from that we can say the dynamic load capacity C is equal to P into L10 raised to 1 by P. Okay. So the relationship between life in million revolutions and life in working hours is given by this equation. L10 is equal to 60 N L10H by 10 raised to 6. Okay, so here this L10H, L10 is the rated bearing life in hours, and N is the speed of rotation. Okay, speed of rotation. So this is called the load life relationship. Okay, relation between the life in million revolutions and life in working hours, L10H and L10. Now, selection of bearing life. Okay, so while selecting the proper size of bearing, it is necessary to specify the expected life of the bearing for the given application. So the information regarding the life expectancy is generally vague, and values based on past experience are used. So for all kind of vehicles, the speed of rotation is not constant, and the desired life is expressed in term of millions of revolutions. Okay, so the recommended bearing life for the wheel application, okay, is given in this table. So you can see life year million revolution for the automobile cars. Okay, it is 50 million revolution. For trucks, the life of the bearing is 100 million revolutions. For trolley cars, it is 500 million revolution. For railroad cars, it is 1000 million revolutions. Okay, so in the other applications, the speed of rotation is relatively constant, and the desired life is expressed in terms of hours of service. So for that, the recommended bearing life for some of the applications is given in this table. So you can see the machines use intermittently, such as lifting tackle, hand tools, and household applications. Okay, here the speed remains constant, nearly to the constant. So for that, the life of the bearing is 4000 to 8000 hours. Okay, then machines used for the 8 hours of service per day, such as electric motors and gear drives. So for that, the bearing life for the industrial bearing life is 12,000 to 20,000 hours. And machines used for the continuous operations, that is 24 hours per day, such as pumps, compressors, and conveyors, for the some continuous applications, in which the life of the bearing is 40,000 to 60,000 hours. Okay, so the value given in these tables are only for the general guidance. Okay, so for a particular applications, the designer should consider the past experience and the difficulties faced by the customer in replacing the bearing and the economics of breakdown costs. So on that base, the designer will define the life of the bearing. Okay. Then load factor. Okay. So the forces acting on the bearings are calculated by considering the equilibrium of forces in vertical and horizontal planes. So this elementary equations do not take into consideration the effect of dynamic load. So the forces determined by these equations are multiplied by a load factor to determine the dynamic load carrying capacity of the bearing. So that load factors are used in application involving the gear, chain and belt drives. Okay, so in gear drives, there is an additional dynamic load due to the inaccuracies of the tooth profile and the elastic deformation of teeth. Okay, so in chain and belt drives, the dynamic load is due to vibrations. Okay, so here you can see the different values of the load factors. Okay, and here the types of applications. Okay, so it is multiply the design load by load factor. So precision gearing, the load factor is given 1.0 to 1.1. For commercial gearing, it is 1.1 to 1.3. For applications with poor bearing seals, 1.2. Machinery with no impact, 1 to 1.2. Machinery with light impact, 1.2, 1.5. And machinery with moderate impact, 1.5 to 3. So here you can see when the impact load is increasing, then the value of the load factor is increasing from this table, you can see. Okay. So these values are used in the absence of precise analysis of dynamic forces. So this is the load factor which is used in the bearing. Then next is the selection of bearing from manufacturer's catalog. Okay. So the basic procedure for the selection of bearing from the manufacturer catalogs, it consists of the different steps. Okay, and the different manufacturers have their own catalogs. Okay, so according to that, we have to generally select the bearings. The standard bearings are available in the market, so we have to select as per the our applications from the manufacturer's catalog. Okay, so very first step is to calculate the radial and axial forces acting on the bearing and determine the diameter of shaft where the bearing is to be fitted. Okay, so very first step is we have to determine the diameter of the shaft where the bearing is to be fitted. Then second step is the select the type of bearing for the given application. Okay, whether it is a ball bearing, it is a roller bearing, it is the angular contact bearing, taper roller bearing. So according to the application, select the type of a bearing. Then we have to find out the next one is the value of the X and Y from the catalog. Okay, so you can see here the value of the X and Y you can find from this catalog. The value of FA is the axial load and C0 is the static load carrying capacity. So its value is given here. If FA by FR is less than E, okay, then value of X is 1, here you can see, and value of Y is 0, okay, for the given value of FA upon C0. Now here, if FA upon FR, okay, ratio of axial to the radial load is greater than E, then value of X is, you can see, 0.56, value of Y is 2. For this value, it is 0.56. So you can see the value of X is remains constant, 0.56. And the value of Y is 2, 1.8, 1.6, 1.4, 1.2, and 1. And you can see these are the different values of E. Okay. So this value depends upon the two ratio. You can see the ratio of FA upon FR and FA upon C0. Okay. It depends upon the FA upon C0, where C0 is the static load capacity. Okay. So the selection of the bearing is done by trial and error. Okay, so the static and dynamic load capacity of single-loaded through ball bearing of the different series okay, is given here in this table. Okay, then next step is calculate the equivalent dynamic load from the equation that we have already there. That is the P is equal to X into FR plus Y into FA. Then make a decision about the expected bearing life and express the life L10 in million revolutions. Then calculate the dynamic load capacity from the equation, that is the C P L10 raised to 1/3. Okay, then check whether the selected bearing of series 60 has the required dynamic capacity. If not, then select the bearing of the next series and go back to the step 3 and continue. Okay, so in this way you can select the bearing from the manufacturer's catalog. Okay, now design for cyclic load. Okay, design for the cyclic load and speed. So in certain applications, the ball bearings are subjected to the cyclic load and speeds. Okay, so as an example, consider a ball bearing operating under the following conditions. The radial load is 2500 newton at 700 rpm for 25% of time. Then radial load of 5000 newton at 900 rpm for the 50% of the time, and radial load 1000 newton at 750 rpm for the remaining 25% of the time. Okay, so under these circumstances, it is necessary to consider the complete work cycle while finding out the dynamic load capacity of the bearing. So the procedure, it consists of the consists of dividing the work cycle into the number of elements, okay, during which the operating conditions of load and speeds are constant. Now suppose that the work cycle is divided into X element. Okay, work cycle is divided into the X elements. Then let this P1, P2 up to PX be the loads, and N1, N2 up to the NX be the speeds during these elements. Okay, so during the first element, the life L1 corresponding to the load P1 is given by the equation, that is L1 is equal to C upon P1 raised to 3 into 10 raised to 6 revolution. Okay, L1 is to C by P1 raised to 3 into 10 raised to 6 revolution. Now in one revolution, the life consumed is 1 upon L1, or we can say 1 upon L1 or is equal to P1 raised to 3 or P1 cube by C cube into 1 upon 10 raised to 6. Okay, now let us assume that the first element consists of N1 revolutions. So therefore, the life consumed by the first element is given by N1 P1 cube upon 10 raised to 6 C cube. Similarly, the life consumed by the second element is given by N2 P2 cube by 10 raised to 6 C cube. So adding this all the expressions, the life consumed by the complete work cycle is given by N1 P1 cube upon 10 raised to 6 C cube plus N2 P2 cube by 10 raised to 6 C cube plus NX PX cube upon 10 raised to 6 C cube. Okay, now if PE is the equivalent load for the complete work cycle, the life consumed by the work cycle is given by N PE cube upon 10 raised to 6 C cube, where this N is equal to N1 plus N2 up to NX. Okay, so equating the expression A and B, equation A and B, we can say N1 P1 cube plus N2 P2 cube plus up to nx px cube is equal to n px n pe cube. So therefore pe is equal to cube root of n1 p1 cube plus n2 p2 cube plus so on and by n1 plus n2 plus up to nx. Okay, so this is the design procedure for the cyclic loads. Okay, then bearing with a probability of survival other than 90%. Okay, so in the definition of rating life, okay, so it is mentioned that the rating life is the life that 90% of group of identical bearing will complete or exceed before fatigue failure. Okay, so the reliability R is defined as a number of bearing, ratio of number of bearing which have successfully completed L minimal revolution upon total number of bearings under test. This is called the reliability. So therefore the reliability of bearings selected from the manufacturer's catalog is 0.9 or 90%. Okay, but in certain applications where there is risk of human life, so it becomes necessary to select a bearing having a reliability of more than 90%. Okay, so the distribution of bearing failure. Okay, so the relationship between bearing life and reliability is given by a statistical curve, okay, which is known as Weibull's distribution. Okay, this statistical curve is known as Weibull distribution. Here we, this is the life of the bearing and percentage of bearing in service. Okay, so here you can see this is the L10 life where 90% reliability and L15 life, 50 life where the 50% of reliability. So this relationship between the bearing life and this reliability is given by the statistical curve that is known as Weibull distribution, which R is equal to E raised to minus L by A raised to B. Okay, L by A, R is equal to E raised to minus L by A raised to B, where R is the reliability in fraction and L is the corresponding life and A and B are the constant. Okay, A and B are, they are known as the constant. Now from that, okay, rearranging this equation, you will get the 1 upon R is equal to E raised to L by A raised to B. So therefore log E 1 upon R is equal to L upon A raised to B. Now if L10 is the life corresponding to the reliability of 90% or R90, then here we can say R90 here L10 upon A raised to B. Okay, now dividing this equation A by B, dividing equation A by B. So L upon L10 is equal to log E 1 upon R, log E 1 upon R90 raised to 1 by B, where R90 is equal to 0.9. So the value of A and B are A is equal to 6.84 and B is equal to 1.17. So these values are obtained from the condition where L50 is equal to 5L10. Okay, where L50 is the median life or life which 50% of bearing will complete or the exceed before the fatigue failure. So this equation C, okay, this equation C is used for selecting the bearings when the reliability is other than 90%. Okay, now bearing failure. Okay, so there are two basic types of the bearing failure, that is the breakage of parts like races or cages and the surface destructions. Okay, so the fracture in the outer race of ball bearing occurs due to overload. So when the bearing is misaligned, the load acting on some balls or the rollers sharply increased and may even crush them. Okay, so the failure of case is caused due to the centrifugal force acting on the balls. So the complete breakage of parts of the ball bearing can be avoided by selecting the correct ball bearing, adjusting the alignment between the axis of the shaft and housing, and operating within permissible speeds. Okay, so in general, the failure of anti-friction bearing occurs not due to the breakage of parts, but due to damage of working surfaces of their parts. Okay, so the principal types of the surfaces, surface wear, they are the abrasive wear, corrosive wear, fitting and scoring. So abrasive wear means abrasive wear occurs when the bearing is made to operate in an environmental contaminated with dust, foreign particles, rust or spatters. So the remedies against this type of wear are provision of oil seals, increasing surface hardness and use of high viscosity oils. Okay, so the thick lubricating film developed by these oils allows fine particles to pass without scratching. Then corrosive wears, the corrosion of surfaces of bearing parts is caused by the entry of water or moisture in the bearing. So it is also caused due to the corrosive element present in the extreme pressure additives that are added in the lubricating oils. Okay, so this element attacks and surface of the bearing, it resulting in the fine wear uniformly distributed over the entire surface. Remedies against this type of wear are providing complete enclosure for the bearing free from external contamination. Then pitting is the main cause of the failure of anti-friction bearing. So pitting is a surface fatigue failure which occurs when the load on the bearing part exceeds the surface endurance strength of the material. So this type of failure is characterized by pits which continue to grow, resulting in complete destruction of the bearing surface. So pitting depends upon the magnitude of Hertz contact stress and number of stress cycle. Okay, so the surface endurance strength can be improved by increasing the surface hardness. Then scoring. Scoring, it means the excessive surface pressure, high surface speed and inadequate supply of lubricants result in breakdown of lubricant film. So this results in excessive frictional heat and overheating at the contacting surfaces. Okay, so scoring is a stick slip phenomenon in which alternate welding and shearing take place rapidly at high spots. Okay, so the rate of wear is faster. Scoring can be avoided by selecting the parameters such as surface speed, surface pressure and the flow of lubricant in such a way that the resulting temperature at the contaminating surface is within permissible limits. Okay, then last topic is the lubrication of rolling contact bearing. Okay, so the guidelines for selecting the lubricants are: when the temperature is less than 100 degrees centigrade, the grease is suitable, while the lubricating oils are preferred for applications where the temperature exceeds 100 degrees centigrade. When the product of bore in millimeter by speed, the product of bore and speed is below 2 lakhs, then grease is suitable. For higher values, the lubricating oil are recommended. And grease is suitable for low and moderate loads, while the lubricating oils are used for heavy duty applications. If there is a central lubricating system which is required for the lubrications of other parts, the same lubricating oil is used for bearings, that is the gearboxes. Okay, so the choice of lubricating oil is necessary for high speed, heavy load applications, while in the remaining majority of applications, grease offers the simplest and cheapest mode of lubrications. So now I hope you can understand very well, and in our next lecture we will solve the examples of this bearing. Okay, examples of anti-friction bearing. Thank you.